Whenever we open a new window on the universe, we discover things that no one expected. Our newfound ability to measure the ripples in the fabric of space-time, gravitational waves, is a very new window, and so far we've seen a lot of wild stuff. We've observed black holes merging, and their oddly high masses challenges our understanding of black hole formation and growth. We've seen colliding neutron stars that have forced us to rewrite our ideas of how many of the elements of the periodic table get made. But what else might be hiding in the ripples of space-time? Oh, I know. How about the gravitational wakes caused by planet-sized alien spacecraft accelerating to near light speed? The Laser Interferometer Gravitational Wave Observatory, LIGO, was built with some very particular natural phenomena in mind. In particular, merging black holes and neutron stars, which we've now seen, and supernova explosions, which we haven't yet. Gravitational waves are produced whenever an object with mass is accelerated. And so we're constantly bathed in a complex network of space-time ripples. LIGO could only see the most powerful of these caused by very massive objects undergoing extreme acceleration, and those only within a certain frequency range. Still, it's worth asking what else might LIGO be able to see? For example, could an alien spacecraft be massive enough and accelerate rapidly enough to produce observable gravitational waves? Well, that was the question asked by Luke Sellers and team. Their recent paper introduces the Rama craft, the rapid and massive accelerating spacecraft, a ship that creates a wake of detectable space-time ripples. But just how massive and how rapidly accelerating, and how close to us would a Rama craft have to be for LIGO to be sensitive to it? Well, let's find out. Let me add a couple of notes of caution. First, this paper has not yet passed through the peer review process, although you can get it on the preprint archive. Second, we have not observed signals like this, at least as far as anyone has noticed. The paper is extremely speculative, and in a way it's just a bit of fun. But beneath the fun premise, the paper asks a serious question. Given LIGO's capabilities and known sensitivity, what kind of other signals might it be capable of detecting? First though, a brief reminder about gravitational waves and LIGO. We've covered this stuff before, of course. Now, Einstein's general theory of relativity predicts that accelerating masses create self-propagating ripples in space-time, just as accelerating electric charges make ripples in the electromagnetic field, also known as light. Gravitational waves are waves in the fabric of space and time. They change lengths and durations as they pass by. LIGO spots gravitational waves by detecting the tiny variations in the relative lengths of its 4-kilometer-long arms. Those arms alternately grow and shrink as the wave passes by, and from the pattern of those changes, we can identify the nature of the gravitational wave source. The two LIGO detectors in Washington and Louisiana in the US, and with the help of their cousins, the European Virgo and the Japanese Kagra, can triangulate the location of the source of a gravitational wave. Now, it's super easy to make gravitational waves. Just flap your arms up and down, and you're emitting gravitational waves. Making detectable gravitational waves is a different story. Gravity is by far the weakest force, so while our electromagnetic signature of our little chicken dance is all too observable, you're effectively invisible in gravitational waves. To make detectable gravitational waves, you need really big masses and you need to wiggle them really, really hard. For example, a pair of black holes in a binary orbit are accelerating towards each other, and so generate gravitational waves. These waves carry away energy, causing the black holes to sink closer together. In a tighter orbit, they move faster, and the stronger acceleration results in stronger gravitational waves at higher frequencies. If a pair of black holes the mass of our sun were to spiral together, then just before merger, they'd be moving at roughly half the speed of light. And the power they radiate in gravitational waves is more than the power emitted in light by all the stars in the observable universe. And this is what LIGO was designed to be sensitive to, the most powerful bursts of waves emitted right at the end of such an in-spiral. I made a point of emphasizing that it's not the speed of the black holes that creates gravitational waves, but rather the acceleration. More precisely, it's the change in the quadrupole moment of the mass distribution, but let's just think about acceleration because that's what we need for today. A black hole moving at an insane but constant speed in a straight line wouldn't emit waves, but orbiting black holes do emit waves because they're accelerating towards the center of mass of the binary system. But there are potentially other types of acceleration besides orbits. For example, we have linear acceleration, just good old speeding up in a straight line. So what speeds up in a straight line? Well, people trying to get somewhere. So what if those people are aliens yeeting themselves through the cosmos? In the paper we're looking at today, the team does a pretty straightforward general relativity calculation to figure out what the gravitational radiation should look like for a massive body accelerating at a constant rate. And importantly, in what circumstances LIGO could detect that. Gravitational waves in four-dimensional spacetime are hard to visualize, so let's start with an analogy. Waves on the surface of water. An in-spiraling orbit is a bit like stirring the water in circles. The ripples expand outwards. But a linearly accelerating object makes something more like the wake of a boat. And it's this wake that would wash over the Earth and LIGO, and we could potentially detect. In order to figure out what types of spaceship wake LIGO could detect, we need to work backwards. We need to figure out the mass and acceleration rate that would produce a gravitational wave with the right intensity and frequency to be detected by LIGO. Let's start with frequency. Just like with telescopes, LIGO is optimized for a specific range of frequencies. It's sensitive to gravitational waves between a few tens of hertz to a few thousand hertz, with the sweet spot somewhere in the middle of that range. Outside that range, the noise gets too loud and tends to drown out real signals. The frequency of a gravitational wave is roughly equal to the frequency of the phenomenon that produced it, or the inverse of the timescale of that phenomenon, which would be the orbital period in the case of in-spiraling objects. LIGO is designed to be most sensitive to the frequency of in-spiraling black holes just before they merge, and particularly to the mass range expected for black holes produced in the death of massive stars. It's just a coincidence that the resulting frequencies are in the range of human hearing, as long as you convert the gravitational wave to a sound wave first. Okay, so what frequency is a spaceship wake? It's a little more complicated than the frequency of a black hole merger. The gravitational wave signal ends up being a mix of frequencies, some high, some low, but crudely speaking, larger acceleration means more energy emitted in higher frequency waves, while lower accelerations have stronger low frequency waves. For an accelerating spacecraft, it's nicer to think about this in terms of the time spent accelerating. If we assume that the aliens want to reach a certain maximum speed, say a certain fraction of the speed of light, then the acceleration is determined by the amount of time taken to reach that speed. The longer the acceleration time to reach a given speed, the stronger the low frequency waves will be. We can also think about this in terms of wavelength. Low frequency means long wavelength, and the longer our craft spends accelerating, the longer the gravitational wave it can emit. Based on LIGO's frequency sensitivity and assuming acceleration to 30% the speed of light, this team of scientists figures that they'd need to reach that speed from standstill in just a few tenths of a second in order to be detectable by LIGO. And that's really slamming the foot, or the pseudopod, or the plasma tentacle, or whatever, on the gas pretty hard. But just how massive and how nearby would such a craft need to be in order to be detectable by LIGO? Well, the more massive the craft, the stronger its gravitational wake. Now, LIGO is a very sensitive instrument, capable of detecting changes in the lengths of its arms by a thousandth the width of a proton, and that lets us spot black holes merging a billion light years away. In fact, LIGO could also detect acceleration of a starship an entire universe away if that starship had the mass of the entire sun. That's a solar mass accelerated to 30% light speed in a fraction of a second. not too plausible, perhaps. Although we are talking about the hundreds of billions of galaxies, each with hundreds of billions of stars, and we just need one civilization in all of that to reach this frankly absurd technological power. Still, it sounds pretty iffy. But thinking more modestly, how massive would the craft have to be in order for an acceleration inside the Milky Way to be visible? Well, from the other side of the galaxy, it would have to be the mass of Jupiter. Moving a Jupiter mass to a good fraction of light speed in less than a second is still pretty far out, and still doesn't seem likely that such insane levels of tech exist in our galaxy, given that we don't see any other evidence for it. If this were to happen closer to Earth, say within 30 light years, our local stellar neighbourhood, then we could potentially detect a moon mass accelerating ship. Some of you may remember that warp fields do require the entire mass energy of a star or of Jupiter or of a moon, depending on how you calculate it. Now, maybe that's a way to produce the stupid accelerations required, while at the same time protecting the Rama craft from the cataclysmic g-forces of that acceleration. Unfortunately, the known warp-filled solutions don't produce the same space-time wakes as simply accelerating a large mass. But perhaps there are undiscovered warp solutions that can do this job. But however they do it, the aliens are going to need to access an unthinkable amount of energy. Remember that a single merging black hole binary produces more power in gravitational waves than are emitted by all the stars in the universe, just for an instant. Scale that down to a mere planet mass craft, and we're still talking entire galaxies, or at least many stars worth of power. This all sounds pretty out there. But this isn't quite a fool's errand. There are a couple of good reasons that we might want to think about weird sources of gravitational waves, whether Rama craft or otherwise. We mostly think about looking for aliens through electromagnetic radiation, whether they're radio transmissions, their planet covering city lights, or the light blotted out by their Dyson spheres. But the problem with electromagnetic waves is that they dim very quickly with distance. The intensity of light drops as the square of its distance. Double your distance from a light source and it's quarter the strength. 10 times further away and it's a factor of 100 fainter. In addition, electromagnetic observatories, especially traditional telescopes, but also to some extent radio observatories, tend to be limited to relatively small patches of the sky at a time, which further slows the process of looking for this stuff. Due to this, our searches for artificial electromagnetic signals are pretty much limited to nearby stars in the Milky Way. For example, even the most ambitious search to date, Breakthrough LISTEN, has an ongoing goal of observing a million stars and a handful of exotic candidates, requiring literally years worth of observing telescope time on some of the biggest radio dishes in the world, and that's just a fraction of a percent of the stars in the Milky Way. In contrast, the strain or stretching and squishing of space caused by gravitational waves weakens not as an inverse square law, but just as an inverse law. Being 10 times further away only means being 10 times weaker in strain versus being 100 times weaker. Another convenient fact about gravitational waves is that they pass through anything. Photons are easily blocked by a bit of dust between the stars or by our atmosphere, but gravitational waves are literal space-time ripples. All the matter they pass through just kind of wibble-wobbles a bit, and the wave passes by largely unaffected. So we are able to monitor gravitational waves coming from all directions, constantly, and to very large distances. So if that gigatech civilization is out there with its stupidly large spaceship, we will detect it, as long as it's close enough. Now, there are other gravitational wave observatories that can or will do better than LIGO in some respects. The upcoming LISA, the Laser Interferometer Space Antenna, will have arms a million times longer than LIGO, and that means it's sensitive to frequencies almost a million times lower. It's a little complicated to make a direct comparison of frequency sensitivity, but adding the fact that LISA is able to monitor uninterrupted for many days due to the lack of gravitational noise out there in space, means it should be able to detect Rama craft that takes several days to accelerate. Then there's the pulsar timing array, a gravitational observatory consisting of pulsars scattered across the Milky Way. It could be sensitive to craft that accelerate over months or years. Now, these crafts still need to be of Jupiter-ish masses for us to spot them from across the Milky Way. But now at least the aliens don't have to get whiplash from the G-forces in order to be seen. We probably are not going to see Rama craft. They're just a bit too outlandish to be likely. On the other hand, we would not want to miss them if they exist. And on the other hand, we may well see signals with LIGO and its relatives and successors that look like linearly accelerating masses. And this paper does a good job of laying out what the physical conditions of such phenomena would have to be for us to spot them. For example, we could have orbiting black holes with highly elongated orbits, or maybe a star or giant planet accelerating as it plummets into an enormous black hole, or some weird type of supernova where an intact chunk of its core gets exploded out. The universe does weird stuff all the time, and it's good to know what to look for, as long as we don't immediately conclude that it's aliens, because it's never aliens. But it would be cool to find out that there are planet-sized spacecraft hooning around the other side of the galaxy, leaving us sloshing around in their wakes of rippling spacetime.